to each of you. Hope everybody can hear me. No, you were not late, Mario. I think I was. So today is actually the sixth session that we're going to do in the covenants of the Bible. Today we're going to take a look at the covenant that God made with David. It's commonly called the Davidic covenant. So our format, yes, Mom, I noticed you have a birthday. Is it today or tomorrow? You're getting old like me. Actually, dear Mom is, whoa. Okay, you're a decade ahead of me, Mom. So it's great to know you. Great to have you here. I've known Mom for some time, probably 12 to 15 years. So it's wonderful to have you here. Happy birthday and blessings to you today. So our format again is worship. We're going to have some worship and I'm going to start off with a song, but I want to give a little bit of introduction to the song because it has a wonderful, wonderful story behind it. The author of the song was named George Matheson. He lived in the 19th century and he wrote the words to a song, Oh Love, the song that we're going to listen to, but it has a story behind it. George was studying to be a pastor. He ended up pastoring a church of over 1,500 people. That's pretty good for the 1860s. But at the age of 20, he had a rare disease whereby he was going blind at 20 years old. Just an amazing story. But he continued to preach, he continued to study, and he continued to preach and study and wanted to go to the mission field for the rest of his life. Well, at that age, he asked a young lady, here's the story behind the hymn. He asked a young lady for her hand in marriage. And she turned him down because she told him she did not want to live the rest of her life with a husband who was going to be blind. He was so heartbroken and so depressed, he sat down and wrote these words out. And he even wrote, I read in the article that he wrote, he said, it took me about 5 minutes. It's like the words just flowed from my pen. So here he is, rejected, turned away, and he pens these words, Oh, love that will not let me go. I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean depths is flow, may richer, fuller be. If you ever sing that song, you're going to remember this story of George Matheson. So let us worship together with his song. I found a modern version of it that we can look at and sing together. So let's listen to our worship song. And when you are done, just click done into the room and we'll start with the study.
Oh, love that will not let me go. I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe. That in thine ocean depths its flow may richer, fuller be. O light that followest all my way, I yield my flickering torch to thee. My heart restores its borrowed ray. Sunshine's blaze, its day may brighter, fairer be. O joy that seekest me through pain, I cannot close my heart to thee. I trace the rainbow through the rain and feel promise is not vain, that morn shall tearless be. liftest up my head. I dare not ask to fly from thee. I lay in dust, life's glory dead, and from the ground there blossoms red, life that shall endless be. That shall endless peace, endless peace, endless
Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you that you have an everlasting love that will never let us go. And even through the pain, through the sorrow, through the suffering, you are there. And you are a God of covenant. You are a God of promise. You are a God who has promised to always be with us, and be in us, and be for us. Thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your goodness, your loving kindness. Lord, you are the rock, and your work is perfect, and all your ways are justice. You are a God of truth, and without iniquity, just and right, merciful, true are you. Lord, we ask you to speak to us through this word today, that we may grow closer to you, that we may know you better, and that we may reflect your glory in all the things that we do and say. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. So, we have found in our study that throughout Scripture, God has manifested himself as the Lord of Covenant. We've seen it in Adam and Eve. We've seen it in Noah. We've seen it in Abraham. And we've seen it in Moses. And we've seen it in the nation of Israel. God has been the sovereign, electing, the initiating, faithful Lord to redeem a people to himself for his glory. So his redemptive purposes have been unfolding throughout Scripture as he progressively reveals his truth to us. And the history of this unfolding can best be understood through covenant. We can best understand what God is doing in his church, in his people, and it's through covenant. So as we read Scripture, we know Scripture is made up of various genres. There's narrative, there's historical narrative, there's poetry, there's prophetic literature. And through it all, God has seen using covenants to unfurl his redemptive plan. From the first Adam to the second Adam, Jesus Christ, the Lord God worked through his chosen people to reconcile his created order unto himself. So covenants play a major role in the development of the Bible's central message. That is the satisfaction of the Lord Jesus Christ on behalf of his people. So knowing God means knowing that he is and he will be utterly faithful to the covenant that he makes on our behalf. If you read back in Genesis, if you remember at the end of Genesis, Joseph had been sent ahead through God's providence. And we see the sons getting back together and all of Israel coming to live in the land of Egypt. And at the very end in Genesis 49, Jacob begins to bless each one of the 12 sons. And there's a lot of prophetic things said in that chapter. If you want to go back and read it sometime, we see Jacob passing over Reuben, who was the firstborn. He passed over Simeon. He passed over Levi and gave Judah the ultimate blessing. Now, remember that Judah means praised. He calls Judah a lion's cub. This is partially where we get our phrase, the lion from the tribe of Judah. It finds its origins here in Genesis 49. In verse 10, Jacob says that the scepter shall not depart from Judah, which signifies that royalty will come from this tribe, from the tribe of Judah. This dynasty, this kingdom shall not depart, Jacob adds, until tribute comes to him. Other versions of the Bible render this phrase, until he comes to whom it belongs, or until Shiloh comes, or until he comes to Shiloh. So whatever the absolute meaning, all interpretations see this phrase as referring to a future covenant with someone in the line of Judah, and quite possibly to the coming of a king greater than even David. So God's covenant with David centers on the coming of the kingdom. This is the primary thrust of the covenant that we're going to take a look at today, and that is the coming, the establishment, and the coming of the kingdom of God that will never end. So this covenant serves as the formalizing bond by which God's kingdom comes among his people. God is establishing a kingdom, an unshakable kingdom that will never end. He works through in the establishment of his kingdom through covenant faithfulness to those whom he has redeemed from every tribe, from every nation, and every tongue. Now, as we've gone through these, you'll notice that there is some continuity within the covenants, and there's some discontinuity. As we look at the Davidic covenant, this represents the climax of the unfolding of the covenant of grace in the Old Testament. In the Hebrew Scriptures, the Davidic covenant provides the consummation and the climax of all the previous administrations of the one covenant of grace. Remember that any dealings God has in even recognizing a people and calling them to himself is always an act of grace and mercy. Think of it this way. God has no obligations to do so. He has absolutely no duty to reveal anything to us, much less show us mercy, but he does. And I am glad for that. Later, there's going to be a recognition that a future new covenant was coming, but not yet realized. These will be prophesied in the book of Ezekiel and in the book of Jeremiah and elsewhere. We'll take a look at those hopefully next week. So the Davidic covenant follows both the Abrahamic and the Mosaic covenants. And there are explicit indicators that the Davidic covenant is the continual fulfillment of the Abrahamic covenant. One thing that kings were supposed to do, and let me give you that scripture here. In Deuteronomy 17, God gives these instructions through Moses. Speaking of instructions for kings, when you come into the land and you have a king, this is what he says. And then he continues and he says these words. And when he, that is the king, sits on the throne of his kingdom, he shall write for himself in a book a copy of this law approved by the Levitical priests. And it shall be with him, and he shall read it all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God by keeping all the words of this law and these statutes and doing them, that his heart may not be lifted up above his brothers, and that he may not turn aside from the commandment either to the right hand or to the left, so that he may continue long in his kingdom, he and his children in Israel. So you see, this is the establishment, basically, of a theocracy. There was no modern day separation of church and state. It was one unit. The king ruled in righteousness, and the king ruled under the authority of God. So every king was required to copy down their own copy of the book of Moses, or what's commonly called the Torah. Remember that Torah means instruction, specifically instruction in righteous living. God redeems a people, he adopts them as his own children, and then he instructs them in the way of truth. Their kingship was to be based on the revelation that God had made through Moses. So we see here that the king was over the kingdom to instruct the people how to live as redeemed God's people. So here is the aspect of a mediator, which is revealed in the Davidic covenant. This goes back to the Mosaic covenant. Moses was appointed as mediator to teach the people that we need a mediator. We need someone to stand between us and God. When the king takes up that role of mediator, he takes up the role that has been displayed in the life of Moses. So here we see the Davidic covenant, and the Davidic covenant being this extension of the Mosaic covenant, and it is the mainstream of the covenant of grace, as we'll see as we go along. First, we're going to look at the historical background. What is going on in the life of David here? Okay, we need to take a look at what is going on in the life of David. David had been anointed as king over all of Israel. And we see in that position as king, David is beginning to take authority over the nations around them. First, he's taken Jerusalem from the Jebusites, and he has established the permanent locality of his throne in Jerusalem. That's in 2 Samuel chapter 5. He had ruled for 7 years from Hebron, a city located in the midst of a territory belonging to David's own tribe of Judah. But now he moves to capture a city not yet taken by Israel and more centralized to the entire nation of Israel. Then in the next chapter, 2 Samuel 6, I'm just referring to these so you can go back and read them at your leisure, David brought the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of God, to Jerusalem in 2 Samuel 6. In doing this, this symbolically represented something. He publicly displayed his desire to see his own rule in Israel related immediately to the throne of God. In this manner, then, the concept of the theocracy found its fullest expression. David was symbolizing here that we are one people joined together, redeemed under the hand of God Almighty. And he was to rule and reign with justice and righteousness. So think of it this way. Prophetically, the anointing of David is also crucial for understanding the Old Testament idea of Messiah, or Mashiach. I don't know how to pronounce that correctly in Hebrew. I beg your pardon on that. The Hebrew term Mashiach means anointed one, okay? In the Greek, it translates, or Latin, to the word Christos, which is the Christ, meaning Jesus was Christ, the anointed one. So the idea of Messiah for Israel grows out of an ideology about a righteous king, one who would be like David, the rule of David as God's anointed one, his Messiah. He was not the Messiah, but he is the anointed one for that time. This terminology is later used by the prophets to picture the coming of the future messianic king. We see it all over Isaiah. Think of the the verses we sing at Christmas, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive, unto us a child is born." These are familiar passages in Isaiah. And it is in Christ that David's seed is established forever and his throne built up to all generations. So David has been granted success. We read in 2 Samuel 7, now we're up to chapter 7, we will take a look at the covenant specifically. It says in 2 Samuel 7, 1 that David had been granted success in his reign against the surrounding enemies, that God had given David rest from all his enemies. In other words, he secured the throne in Israel to a degree that never had been experienced previously. Instead of being threatened constantly by attacking armies, Israel became as secure as a national entity. Now, of course, not all of Israel's foes had been annihilated, but God had given rest from their oppressors. So this success in defeating the worst of the enemies, this sets the stage for the inauguration of the Davidic covenant. And there is a deep, abiding interconnection between God's throne and David's throne that is established by grace on God's part and through faith on David's part. So let's take a look at that covenant here. Pulling a few verses from 2 Samuel chapter 7, okay? Nathan comes in and speaks prophetically to David directly. If you remember, David had wanted to build a temple for the Lord, but Nathan says, no, it will not be you, but it will be your son. Then he says these words, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, that you should be prince over my people Israel. And I will make for you a great name like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house," or that word house or dynasty or kingdom. "When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. When he commits iniquity, I will discipline him, but my steadfast love will not depart from him, and your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever. Your throne shall be established forever." Forever. Notice the perpetuity between that. Not sure what that is, violinist, but it made me laugh. If you remember, recall back to our teaching my teaching on Genesis, when we talked about with Adam, and this was the proto-evangelicum. This is the first announcement of the gospel. What did God say here? I will put enmity. He's speaking to the serpent. He's speaking to the usurper, the liar. To the serpent, I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. You notice this coming of a descendant is over and over through scripture. Here, Nathan in 2 Samuel has just repeated that David will have descendants, that there will be someone on his throne forever and ever. And of course, we know that where that leads, and that leads to Christ Jesus himself. So the climax of the old covenant is found in the coming of the kingdom in David's day. When the king sits on his throne, the kingdom has come. We need to think about that phrase. When the king sits on his throne, the kingdom has come. And I don't want to jump ahead of myself, but I get excited about that. Who is ruling and reigning and sitting on his throne at this very minute? That's the Lord Jesus Christ. When he ascended, he went back to the Father. He sat down at the right hand. The kingdom has been established and it is never ending. I'm getting ahead of myself because this is good stuff. Anyway, so this principle holds true for both the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. The establishment of the House of David is a very important part of God's master redemptive plan to crush the head of the serpent. That's what we just read in Genesis. The majority, after this point in Genesis, the rest of Genesis traces a single line of Seth's descendants, which will eventually produce a king through whom all the nations of the earth will be blessed. The promise of this person comes to fulfillment in Christ Jesus, who is clearly presented in the New Testament as overcoming Satan. So God makes it clear that the placement of David on the throne was of major significance in God's redemptive purposes. This was essential to the establishment of godly rule in Israel. It was important for God's presence, his covenant purposes, and what he was going to do in the future. God had brought his people out of Egypt, given them a land, and driven out their enemies. A good psalm to read when you have time, it's a little bit long, is Psalm 78. It recounts the entire history of Israel. It talks about God rescuing his people, bringing them out, delivering them from their enemies, and bringing them into the promised land. But because of their disobedience, God delivered them into the hands of their enemies. That comes at the end of Psalm 78. God then came to their rescue, established a sanctuary for his presence among them, delivered them from sin, and paved the way to righteousness through setting up David as the shepherd king of Israel. So here we see David at the beginning of this chapter pouring out his heart, his intent to Nathan to establish a home. David understands that he exists to glorify God and him enjoy him forever. David gets acknowledgement from David to do what is in his heart, but then David confirms that the Lord is with David, and Nathan's words are proven to be correct, that the hand of the Lord was upon David, and Nathan's purpose was to affirm the good instincts of David's heart. But then the Lord's response comes. God promises David that he will make for David a great name and declares that he will give Israel rest from their enemies and that he will make a house for David. And he promises that he will establish the kingdom of David's offspring, that his offspring will build the house for the Lord, and that he will establish David's kingdom forever. And he promises in chapter 7, he said, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. Now, those sound very familiar when he says these to David, speaking of Solomon. Of course, we know later. Sounds familiar? The Emmanuel principle, I will be your God and you will be my people. It's almost like he's taking it one step further. Not only am I your God, but now I am your father. Not only are you my people, but now you are my son. You are my adopted son. He takes it one step further. Praise God for his wonderful mercies to include us in his plan of redemption. We could stop and worship now, but let me continue. God's covenant also contains curses for disobedience. Notice that he said it when he goes astray, I will punish him, that I will establish my kingdom with me. If he turns aside from the commandment, either the right or the left, so that he may continue it long, if his heart is lifted up above his brothers, he promises to lead him and guide him. And Hebrews tells us that God disciplines us for our good. So there is curses for disobedience. There is a waywardness that must be corrected. that he will discipline God's offspring if he commits iniquity, but God also promises that his steadfast love will not depart from David as it was taken from Saul. Finally, in 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 16, he says, "And your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." David pours out his heart in gratitude and prayer. That's found at the end of chapter 7. And in his prayer, he refers to God's promise as instruction for mankind, indicating that this covenant will involve the destiny of all mankind, not just Israel. So the Lord reminds David of an important spiritual truth. And he says this in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 6. That verse is 2 Samuel 7, 16, the one I posted. In 7, 6, God tells David, "I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent for my dwelling." Think of it this way: when God's people in Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy, when they dwelt in the wilderness, they lived in tents, and God lived in a tent with them. He never asked them to build a house for him. This is the sovereign God's willingness to identify, to come, to dwell, to tabernacle with his people. This is his Emmanuel principle. This is his, "I will be your God and you will be my people." So the heart of the covenant is the declaration that God is with us. In a word, this brings us into union and communion with the Lord himself. And it emphasizes God's continual presence with his people. When Jesus came in the flesh, it says this, that the Word became flesh and he dwelt, he tented, he tabernacled among us. And we have seen his glory. Glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. He became flesh. He identified with the sinful humanity of his people. And he lived among us, and he dwelt among us, and he lives with us still. So when Christ came in the flesh, he was only emulating what his Father had already done in dwelling with the people in David's day. So the Lord surpasses himself in the way that he blesses David. He emphasizes that he is the one who chose David. He made him ruler. It is God's election and God's appointing. It is nothing less than divine sovereign election and the purposes of God being worked out in redeeming a people for himself. One of the major emphases of the Davidic covenant is this idea of perpetuity, that his kingdom would last forever. David wanted to build for God a permanent dwelling place, but God instead promised that he would establish for David a permanent dynasty. The Hebrew word forever is found 8 times in this chapter, emphasizing the significance of the aspect of the covenant. The main feature of this kingship will be its permanent stability. It will last forever. So what began as a promise that David's son Solomon would be blessed and build the temple turns into something totally different: the promise of an everlasting kingdom. Another son of David would rule forever and ever and build a lasting house. And this is the promised Messiah, Jesus Christ, called the Son of David. Now keep in mind, son of, in the New Testament, often refers to a descendant of. Jesus was not the literal son of David, but he was a descendant of David. So when you read that in the New Testament, understand that. So the promise that David's house, his kingdom, his throne will be established forever. It's significant because it shows that the Messiah will come from the lineage of David, that he will establish a kingdom from which he will reign. The covenant is summarized by the words house, promising a dynasty in the lineage of David. Kingdom, referring to a people who are governed by a king, throne, emphasizing the authority of the king's rule, and forever, emphasizing the eternal and unconditional nature of the promise to David and Israel. Okay, here's an interesting piece of information. There were once opponents, there's been many opponents to biblical truth, of course, throughout time, but there were opponents that claimed that Israel was too tribal. It was too divided. There were too many tribes. They were too scattered out, and there was no communication between them. Therefore, they could never have come under one king such as David. It couldn't happen. There could not be one ruling king in the kingdom of Israel because they were just too spread apart. They were too tribal. They lived in tents. They just couldn't come together. Well, guess what? In 1993, the Tel Dan Stele was found. And there it is. A stele is an inscribed stone. The Tel Dan Stele was found. This was an Aramaic inscription. It was apparently commissioned by Hazael to commemorate his victory at Ramoth Gilead. You'll find that in 2 Kings chapter 8. And it's noteworthy for referring to the kingdom of Judah as the house of David. So we have extra biblical evidence for the fact that the dynasty of David ruled in Jerusalem. What you read in scripture is true. How about that? Even archaeology confirms the truth of scripture. They found this and it's only been recent, 1993, what's that? 27 years ago? Tel Dan Stele, yeah. Thank you, Mario, for spelling that. Yeah, Tel Dan Stele. So the word covenant, notice, is not found in this passage. But the idea of covenant is there, including all the blessings of the covenant, as well as the future administration. However, other passages reflect that it truly was a covenant. We find that in Psalm 89. Let me put that here for you. In Psalm 89, it reads, you have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant, I will establish your offspring forever and build your throne for all generations. So the psalm writer confirms that it is indeed a covenant, and it assures several blessings to David. First, it confirms that his own flesh and blood will occupy the throne. It also confirms that David's heir will fulfill David's desire by building a house for God. And it says that David's heir will stand in unique relationship to God. God will be his father, and he will be God's son. That is a unique relationship that today only believers can stand in that. In the New Testament, believers have the right to address God as father. To the Hebrew ear, this would have been startling because an individual calling God father was unheard of in Israel. Israel, they believed, was collectively God's son, but the language of sonship by one person is not unique to the Old Testament. So David's heir would be his son. David's heir may receive punishment for sins, but will not be cast off like Saul. So God makes a promise that David's house and David's kingdom, his dynasty and rule, would be everlasting, providing the backdrop to the New Testament revelation of Jesus Christ. David's dynasty in terms of duration was the longest dynasty in the ancient Near East, being over 400 years long, far longer than even the Egyptian dynasty. No dynasty in the history of the world lasted as long as David's dynasty. I have not researched any of the Chinese dynasties, but that would be an interesting study to make if someone wants to research that. So, but this promise can only find its fulfillment in one person, and that is the eternal reign of Jesus Christ. So David prays and he thanks God. Now, going to show you an interesting scripture here. There's really, you know, we've talked about signs and seals, okay? In the Abrahamic covenant, the sign of the covenant was circumcision, okay? In this covenant, there is no specific sign, but there is one that is implied, and that is found in 1 Chronicles chapter 29, I believe. Let me find this. Where the writer says, and they made Solomon, this is referring back historically to the reign of Solomon, they made Solomon the son of David king the second time, and they anointed him as prince for the Lord, and Zadok as priest. Then Solomon sat, notice the phrase here, Solomon sat, where did he sit? Not on the throne of Solomon. Solomon sat on the throne of the Lord as king in place of David, his father, and he prospered and all Israel obeyed him. Solomon sat on the throne of the Lord. Why is that important? This is an identification between the rule of God in Israel and the rule of David in his seed. The throne in the Davidic covenant functions to embody the message of the covenant with David. The teaching of the prophetic teaching of the covenant of David points us mostly to the coming of the Messiah, to his work, to his ministry. It points to Jesus in his office as king and Jesus in his preaching of the kingdom. So the throne, it's the throne of the Lord, points to the office of David and his descendants as the uniquely, divinely elected and appointed king of Israel, but also to the rule of God over Israel. Because God is even willing to call the throne of David the throne of Yahweh in this passage of scripture. So clearly, the one who wrote Chronicles has a theological agenda behind that. He is showing you the significance of the Davidic line in the plan of God. He is preparing you for the significance of the split of the nation and the wickedness that occurs from that, and he is relating it to the rejection of that divinely appointed throne of the line of David. When the voice of prophecy went silent after the writing of Malachi, the last prophet, the people of God looked forward to the arrival of their promised king, and they hoped for the day of Elijah, who would come to announce the day of the Lord, the day on which the king would be manifest. And they waited for the coming of that kingdom of God. And that kingdom would come in a manner that was unexpected by some of the people of Israel. So how does this covenant, what does this covenant of David, this Davidic covenant, how does it relate theologically to the New Testament revelation and fulfillment? Well, it was announced by Elijah, but not the exact same Elijah from the days of old. Rather, one went forth in the spirit and power of Elijah, proclaiming the need for repentance and baptism from their sins. Let's look at Luke 3. I'll skip the historical part. Let's come down to the prophecy there, beginning in the middle section there. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall become straight, and the rough places shall become level ways, and all flesh shall see the salvation of the Lord. So the kingdom, while it will be visible, visible, first broke out in an invisible, in a spiritual kingdom. Secondly, we also see pagans and Gentiles coming to look for a king. Very interesting in Matthew. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in the days of Herod the king, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and came to worship him. And then again in Luke 1, we see another prophecy. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people, has raised up a horn of salvation for us in, where? The house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham to grant us. You see the connection there between the Davidic and the Abrahamic promises, all pulled together into one covenant of grace. That is the continuity of God's redemptive plan being fulfilled through all his promises and coming to fruition through the man and God, Jesus Christ. So the coming of Jesus into the world is the fulfillment of all of these covenants. His incarnation, God becoming flesh to redeem his people, would be the fulfillment of all the previous covenants made with man. He came as the ultimate covenant mediator. Distinctive to the Davidic covenant is the permanent establish of one who shall serve in his vital role of mediator, exercising the offices of prophet, priest, and king. So we see here, basically, in this covenant, two promises. One concerns the line of David, one, the promise concerns the locality of Jerusalem. The purposes of God in redeeming a people to himself center on these two points, David's line and Jerusalem's throne. And God is preserving his royal line so that his son can enter into history and fulfill his promises to David. Jesus of Nazareth became the perfect priest, and as the Davidic king, his destiny is inseparable from the destiny of his people. Like many of the Israelite kings before him, he receives the penalty due sin, yet not for his own sin, but for the sins of his people. It says in Isaiah 53, he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So he who knew no sin became sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God. He too is restored after death, but his restoration is permanent. His resurrection is the first fruits of the restoration and renewal of all things that will come at the end of time. And all those in him will dwell securely in a good land. A new earth, and everything, every covenant, every promise of God finds its fulfillment in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And guess what? His kingdom shall have no end, and he shall reign forever and ever. Amen. Praise the Lord for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. While I have time to play you one song. This is called Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of Creation. It's not Chopin. Sorry. And I'll disappoint you a little bit today. There are no key changes. I'm sorry. But you'll enjoy the song anyway. I put the words up there, so if you know it, sing along. Thank you. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a promise keeper, that you are a covenant keeper, that you always had in your heart, your mind to redeem a people for yourself, that you have called us out by your sovereign electing grace, and that you have set our feet on a solid rock. You have transferred us from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of your glorious dear Son. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your word that is everlasting. And Father, we thank you that we will be with you forever. We will forever be your people, and you will be our God. It's only through your divine sovereign grace that this has been accomplished. Father, go with us as we depart from this place. Make us your people to be, show forth, to proclaim your glorious truths as your people of God. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being here, and hope to see you next week. I have some traveling to do this weekend, and I will be around. God bless.